Hey there, welcome back. My name is Everett. You might know me better as Aspiring Spike on the internet, and I'm back here today to record another modern video for Channel Fireball. Today I'm playing something that I've been working on for the last couple weeks. This is a mono black mid-range ramp deck that is pretty heavily featuring the mana generating package of Cabal Coffers Urborg. And this deck has kind of been around in a few different variants since obviously Cabal Coffers got printed into Modern. And it's really never, I've never really taken a serious look at it till recently, and I think that neither have most people either. But MTGO user Trellon has been, and streamer Trellon has been playing a lot of the mono black midrange archetype with Cabal Coffers Urborg. And I've been watching him and a couple other players play the deck, and I actually think that it's pretty powerful. I think that specifically this package of 4 Expedition Map, 3 Profane Tutor, 2 Urborg, 4 Cabal Coffers is really powerful, really consistent, where you're just very, very good at, by turn 4, assembling Cabal Coffers, Urborg, and making a ton of mana. And I've spent a lot of time working on it. Most lists that I saw weren't playing like the cheap discard spells, that, you know, the cheap interaction spells, not playing Liliana of the Veil. But in my opinion, like, playing these like premium cheap interactive cards is just really important to buy time for the mid to late game, so that you are going to be able to overpower your opponent in the late game. And like, the idea of behind playing this deck as a big mana deck instead of Tron and instead of Titan is that, one, you're more resilient to Blood Moon because you just get to cast, you know, a lot of these spells on curve, and two, you get to play this cheap interactive game plan, which I actually think is pretty good. And there's also like been a surprising new printing for this archetype that is actually a big part of its success. Its surprising success is Invoke Despair. Invoke Despair is a new sorcery from Kamigawa Neon Dynasty that says target opponent sacrifices a creature. If they can't, they lose 2 life and you draw a card. Then you repeat that process for enchantment and planeswalker. And when I was looking at like Trellon's list and some other lists, I was like, surely there's got to be something better in the 5 mana spot for Invoke Despair. And 5 mana is really important for this deck because that's how much mana you have on turn 4 with Cabal Coffers Urborg. But the more I looked at it, the more I feel like Invoke Despair is the best 5-drop for this deck, where it buys you time by interacting with your opponent's permanents, it draws you cards so you continuously have gas for your big ramp effects, and it answers enchantments, which is huge for a mono-black deck. So you can actually deal with Blood Moon if you have 4 swamps, you can deal with cards like Spreading Seas on your Urborg or Cabal Coffers. It's actually like really, really good that it can deal with enchantments. And so I've been really surprised and really impressed by Invoke Despair, and the card has just actually kind of been phenomenal. We're also playing 1 copy of Archon of Cruelty and 1 copy of Gristlebrand as 2 like top end over the top threats to draw into in the late game. I've tried the list with 3 8 drops or 1 7 and 2 8 drops. I've tried the list with just 1, and I think the 2 is kind of the sweet spot. And because we have these Profane Tutors to, you know, obviously grab us our mana engine, but also grab us like something to get in the late game after you have your mana engine online, I think it's good to just split them 1-1. You know, Archon of Cruelty is usually better when you're like really behind on board, and obviously when it makes your opponent sacrifice a really relevant permanent, it's great. Like Teferi Time Raveler specifically, Archon can kill, but Gristlebrand is pretty bad into a Teferi Time Raveler a lot of the time. But Gristlebrand is usually better against a card like Solitude, usually better against removal spells on an empty board when you're ahead. So I've been liking the split. And then you'll notice that the sideboard is mostly a Karn sideboard. We have 9 tutor targets for Karn, including the very exciting Bolas's Citadel, which has actually been really strong. And then we have 6 cards that you can bring in when your Fatal Pushes and Damnations are dead. And I think this is really important for the deck's construction to make sure that in matchups like big mana combo control, your Fatal Pushes and Damnations are going to have cards to board in for. And this is, and what's great about the Voidwalkers, the Turok, and the Emrakul is that they're actually really versatile sideboard cards that can come in anywhere. The Emrakul, obviously, so sometimes you're going to bring in one of these instead of the Emrakul, but against combo and some big mana decks, I just actually like to bring in the Emrakul and just hard cast it and go over the top. And obviously this card is also like a nice card to bring in against Mill, and Mill is popular enough that like having the Emrakul is actually a really nice hedge against that matchup. So again, I really, really like the deck. I've done a lot of playing it over my stream the last couple weeks, and I'm excited to showcase it here on Channel Fireball. Before we jump into a league, I do want to remind you guys that this this video is brought to you by the new channel Fireball Marketplace, and you can support your local game stores that are using the marketplace to sell their cards, and you can also use code SPIKE at checkout to help support me if you want to. So without any further ado, we can go ahead and jump into a league. Okay, so we are on the draw for the first match of this league against an Obosh deck, and I'm going to go ahead and keep this. Fatal Push tends to be pretty good against the Obosh decks, and the most common Obosh deck, it looks like what this is, which is a mono-red Blood Moon deck, and so it's actually pretty nice that we can actually just get four swamps in play, so we can cast every card in our deck through the Blood Moon, including Invoke Despair and the Gristlebrand. They didn't end up having a one-mana creature. Relic of Progenesis is fine, doesn't really affect us very much. So I'm going to play the Delta this turn so I can either Revolt, kill a three-mana creature, or just, you know, get my swamp against a Blood Moon. Sorry about the dogs barking outside. Not my dog. Just my neighbors who neglect their dogs. So we can establish a Liliana, but I'm actually going to grab a Profane Tutor here, or suspend a Profane Tutor. Getting a couple of coffers and then a couple turns feels like it'll be pretty important. There's the Blood Moon, so probably not getting Cabal Coffers, but I might grab a land, just another swamp. Okay, let's play the Karn while they've got their relic out there. I'm sorry for the dogs barking. I oftentimes in the afternoons, like, wait and see if the dogs are going to be out barking and try to plan my recording around that. And then sometimes I get bad RNG like this and they're just out there. I like plussing here, stopping them from being able to burn my Karn out very easily. Probably just getting a swamp. Well, I should just still get Cabal Coffers, because I'm gonna make them sack the Blood Moon with the Invoke Despair, and then obviously gonna get to make a lot of mana. So they did miss their land drop last turn. They discard a land this turn and a Bone Crusher Giant, so I'm not sure what I'm missing. Maybe they drew that for turn this turn. Yeah, so let's get the Cabal Coffers. Oh boy. That might be an Archon cast next turn. Yeah, this basically nets one mana. Yeah, so assuming no moon effect, we should be good for an Archon. And I think I'm just going to go ahead and grab a Wyrmcoil Engine here. And I kind of feel like I'm just hard casting Archon next turn, I want to incentivize my opponent to just spend this turn killing the Karn. I guess if they have a Lightning Bolt and they get to kill the Karn without spending any extra mana, but that's okay. Like, if they kill the Karn, and that's it's not going to be that big of a deal, I think. And also, like, if they do Blood Moon again, then they're taking the turn off the Blood Moon. We still have plenty of land drops to hit. We get to hard cast a Wyrmcoil in a couple turns. Cast another Seasoned Pyromancer. Discarding Fury and Din of the Bugbear. So that, you know, that means that if they care about killing Karn, they've got another way to deal a damage or two to it here. I have a hard time thinking my opponent's going to be able to beat Archon plus Wyrmcoil very easily. Okay, they do just have another Fury, pitching Ragavan, killing Karn, attacking me for two down to 17. And assuming I haven't just woefully miscounted, just cast an Archon of Cruelty, get them down to one card in their hands, gain three life up to 20, they pop the relic, two cards in hand, I guess. And it's still full of action, and is, I guess, now even a little more full of action, huh? Kind of an embarrassingly good draw here. I think this has done a pretty good job showing off, like, what the Profane Tutors do in the deck, what the Invoke Despairs does in the deck, how the 8-mana cards play. It's pretty, you know, again, the goal of these videos is always show off the deck I'm working on, show off the ideas at play, and I just always love it when I feel like I get to do that. I think they're casting the Red March here. So, and I think they're deciding that they want to pitch a card to the Red March instead of just casting it. I'm not a big fan of the Red March in these decks. I think I would rather play 3-mana Chandra, Light Up the Stage, just kind of like any other card. They do March pitching Season Pyromancer, revealing Lantern of Insight and Blood Moon. The art is really nice on this, though. I have to give them credit. And they pack it in. Sadly, don't get to cast any of the rest of the fun stuff. I may just resubmit. Kind of depends on like how good I think these Thought Seizes are. I think the Thought Seizes are good enough to keep the full four in. So I'll just go ahead and run it back. You know, because this is a Karn deck, there's a lot of just running it back. Okay, I would say this is a good hand on the draw. I love that we can answer any of their 1-mana creatures. I like this hand a lot. Obviously not making a ton of mana yet. We're also on the draw, and in a lot of ways in this matchup, having basic swamps can be more important than just having all the answers. Okay, so they've got two Blood Moons. Could obviously take one. I think it's just better to take a Seasoned Pyromancer here. And it is bad, you know, that we've got the quadruple black Invoke Despair, but thankfully we're able to find a fetch land. So I think I'm just going to go ahead and... I guess I could have left the fetch up for Revolt for Fatal Push on their turn. Okay, Profane Tutor's not too bad. That can give me my fourth swamp for the Invoke Despair. Maybe it was good to like take one of the two Blood Moons and try to Invoke Despair, but I think I'm just like okay playing through Blood Moon and the season, and they don't really have much going on this game besides the moon. So like usually like when your opponents don't have much going on besides Blood Moon, just leave them with the Blood Moon. Plays a second copy. So yeah, my Invoke Despair is going to be not great until I get the second copy off, I suppose. So my opponent's hand is Fury Mystery Card. I think grabbing Coding is pretty bad because then the card just dies. I think I'm just going to grab Wyrmcoil again. Wyrmcoil was a tutor target like when I was first building the list. Like I was kind of like iffy about it. I wasn't sure if it was something that was mandatory, but I actually find myself getting it all the time. And I think it's one of the better tutor targets. There's a lot of tutor targets you could play that this deck isn't playing, because you know it is a Karn deck. You know, ideally would like to play as many Karn targets as you can afford, but you just can't afford to play all the ones you want to, since like you do have to be able to cut the pushes in a lot of matchups and the damnations. You could also like just, you know, play less of those effects, I guess, but I think it's better to keep them in. So here we kill their Fury, kill their Blood Moon, draw a card, they lose two life, and then we also get to just get the other moon off the field next turn if we want to. I'm not sure that we necessarily want to against the double Den of the Bugbear, but we might. We'll see what we draw. If I play a draw land, I'm just going to slam Wyrmcoil, I think. And we did draw a land, and I'm just gonna slam the coil. If they trade Wyrmcoil for Bone Crusher and Burn Spell, I am a-okay with that trade. I'm going to forget about Obosh, yeah. Poor Obosh always getting forgotten about. I think here I might actually invoke a little spare. I think I'll just tap the Cabal Coffers to... I've got push up for the Den of the Bugbears now. I'm really happy this is happening match one of this league, because like I've been so impressed by Invoke Despair, and I feel like it's really easy to look at this card and just not understand why you want to play it in the deck, and it's just so good at like bridging the gap into the late game, casting a 4-mana off Urborg Cabal Coffers, and deals with like the Blood Moon, Alpine Moon, Spreading Seas. Super unique card, super powerful card. And I also looked at like every Modern Legal 5 drop in black, and like I didn't do a super deep dive, but I did give it the once over, and I didn't really feel like there was a ton of any like really better options either. And I think you really want your 5 drop to be good, of course, in this deck. Oh, sorry, I'm slow. I didn't mean to slow roll. I can just kill them with Invoke Despair. Okay, good first match. I'll see you guys in round number 2. Okay, we are on the play for match 2 with a pretty borderline hand. I think it's probably better to mulligan, but if I knew that my opponent's deck was like incredibly weak to Fatal Push, maybe I would keep. And I think here it's just good to keep, put back the third copy of Invoke Despair. Nothing too wild here. And then usually when I'm in this spot where I have map and just no Cabal Coffers nor Urborg, I basically always get the Urborg first. Since I have, you know, four Cabal Coffers and 2 Urborgs, I'm not only more likely to naturally draw a Cabal Coffers early. Dude, oh, their deck's pretty, hands pretty soft to damnation. Not only am I more likely to draw Cabal Coffers, if I naturally draw a second Cabal Coffers after tutoring one, it's just a disaster if I don't already have the Urborg. Well, another damnation in hand. We probably have a couple turns to draw the fourth land. We are, you know, a 24 land deck with, you know, 3 more expedition maps. Oh my goodness. I'm just so thirsty to come on, land. We do have I'm not playing Hive of the Eye Tyrant. I had a Hive in like an earlier draft. No, I guess I did put back the third Invoke Despair. Now I feel like I'm just definitely getting Spell Queller'd all day. I don't know what they're playing, but you gotta know it's got Spell Queller in it. Oh no, I love Soul Herder so much. I haven't played a Soul Herder deck in so long. I love the Soul Herder decks though. I'm also gonna destroy my opponent if I draw a land. Still no third land, or fourth land, sorry. Skyclave, Vesperlark, Ephemerate. Alright, I'll take the Vesperlark. Yeah, the clock is still relatively slow. Yeah, just hitting me for 5 here. I didn't see... Oh, they exiled Charming Prince to Grail. They didn't scry. Okay, so we're taking... Oh, sorry, 6 because of the Exalted. And then... I guess we have to draw a land this turn, huh? This is gonna hurt. This is gonna really hurt to just, like, never draw the land. Okay, whew. No pain here. I'll lose the Spell Queller with a smile if they have it. Okay, Ephemerate's to scry too. I'm not sure I would have done that. I don't know. Oh, Ephemerate to save the Soul Herder. I see. Of course. Thankfully, we got the second damnation. Then they have the option to Ephemerate the Hierarch to grow the Soul Herder to hit me for an extra point of damage. Pretty interesting call. Weird game so far. They Ephemerate the Soul Herder instead. So they want the Ephemerate in the yard for like Eternal Witness. They're going to Skyclave Apparition Mystery card. What they... I'm a little confused. I guess they just drew it, right? Because they had the Ephemerate on the rebound. We knew their last card going into this was Skyclave. Just like understanding the deck, understanding what you need to do. And so their hand is now Ephemerate, Skyclave Apparition, and then another new card here, which is going to be the Charming Prince. Pretty lucky for us, to be honest, to just naturally draw both damnations. A little less lucky maybe to not find any lands earlier, but... Feeling pretty good. Modern's pretty open these days. There's a lot of like people doing stuff like this. A lot of innovation. I think I'm going to. It's just, no, I think the main way I lose this game is I, like, cling to dust looking for a land, and I hit, like, another expensive spell, and I just get tempoed out. I'm going to grab the Torpa Orb. Torpa Orb is likely to be lights out, especially, like, because I can cling to dust to gain some life. I was thinking about exiling my map, and I could get it back with Karn if I drew a land. All right, taking two down to four. Ooh. They've already played three High Arcs. We're dead to Eternal Witness, get back High Arc, cast High Arc, recast the Invoke Despair. Sorry. We have Urborg, so we don't need to fetch. So we just get to cast the Invoke Despair, not dead to High Arc. Can gain some life with Kling in a second. I haven't found a Cabal Coffers yet. Coffers is almost certainly lights out if we ever do find one. They're very unlikely to flicker that Soul Herder or flicker this Skyclave. What? They're giving me a 4-4? Why would you give me a 4-4? I guess they have an answer to it. They must have an answer to it. Invoking a teensy tiny bit more despair. Then I think I'll just main phase, gain the life. I know it's like a little awkward against Eternal Witness, but I think the only way to lose this game is somehow like they kill my token and counter my Kling. Weird game. Okay, they did have Prismatic Ending. I'm gonna hit for down to one life. Although last time I checked, one is not zero. I think I'm supposed to go for lethal with fetch down to one, push the Soul Herder, cast the Invoke Despair, try to deal them six, and they're at six. Ooh. Well, I guess we'll just take the consolation prize of winning next turn, probably. I doubt that they have any way to haste. Probably not casting Thoughtseize here. If I had to choose between casting Thoughtseize on this board and not casting, I'd say I'd just rather not cast it. Okay, so I don't know if my opponent has any outs to this, but just in case they do, I should probably just have a good habit and grab the second Cabal Coffers, make millions and millions of mana, which I think is the first time we're doing this video. Obviously not super impactful at this point, just kill them. I actually just killed them by casting four Invoke Despairs. That's 20 damage. Okay, I'm going to bring in the Turok. Protection from White is a pretty relevant keyword in this matchup. I think I'm going to trim a Liliana for a Turok and just click Submit. Probably not a bad matchup. Okay, opponent decides to play first. After seeing how good Damnation was that game, I'm just never mulliganing this hand. I know we've got a random Gristlebrand, but this is a great mold of six if you just kind of ignore them. The Gristlebrand, it'll get there eventually too. Okay, opponent's got Charming Prince, Sanctifier, and Vec, which we just get to Damnation. I was chatting a little bit with Trellon, who was again the person who I was kind of got inspired by to work on the archetype. He's been putting a lot of work in on it too, and he was just like, he told me he was shocked by how good this deck was against Sanctifier and Vec. Just like pretty easy card to beat with all your edict effects and damnations. Put in Scry 2, attack me for 1. Yeah, it's just going to take the 4s and then... Yeah, I really actually do not want to kill the Hierarch because I want them to be able to cast the Sanctifier here. And then just try to clean up with a Damnation. Hopefully they don't find another force. It's kind of weird to see a Soul Herder deck not play Yorion. Usually Yorion, I feel, is just so good. Okay, they get back Windswept Heath, so that way they can hold up Ephemerate, which is, yeah, a actual nightmare. Yeah, we're probably dead, actually. I don't know that we could beat the Eternal Witness Ephemerate loop here. That was such an absurd top deck. Oh, they don't cast the Ephemerate, though, because they're scared of, they're scared of Fatal Push. Again, gonna get the Urborg first. Hopefully they grab Teferi. No, they grab the Force, which obviously makes sense. But they've already cast the Ephemerate, so I could maybe just go Bloodsheep's Thirst. If they'll probably end up Force of Negationing on this, and then they'll go Rebound Ephemerate, Return Ephemerate. They'll have Ephemerate up. But then I can go Thoughtseize, take either the Ephemerate or the Force, and then Damnation. I know there's a lot going on, but I think this makes sense. Could get top decked again. They still have Sanctifier and Vec, which I really hope they cast this turn, but I don't think that they will unless they draw a land. So kind of rooting for that land. Yeah, because if they have a land, they can Ephemerate the Force of Negation and play Sanctifier. It's not something that happens, though. And our hand is pretty forced. Thoughtseize go down to 4. They will Ephemerate in response. And then... But we get to take whatever they... Oh, they Ephemerate the Charming Prince. Targeting the Eternal Witness. Oh, man, should I have pushed the Charming Prince? Oh, man, what a play. I guess I should have pushed the Charming Prince. I don't have Revolt. Couldn't see the line. Weird spot to be in. So now I take the Sanctifier and Vec, though. Oh, they have Ice Fang? Yikes. Test of Talents? They didn't Test of Talents the Thoughtseize? I guess I have to take it. Oh, man, yeah, we're pretty dead here. Gonna have to try to sell this in game 3. Cool list. I used to love the Soul Herder decks. Maybe I'll revisit them soon. Yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and pack it in. Okay. Yeah, even Cabal Coffers doesn't save us there. Get to the play for game 3, though, which definitely seems like a really big deal. I don't love this hand. Seems okay. We get to cycle the Cling to Dust. I'm not sure. I think I'm going to mulligan. I think this is a hand that does a deck that does mulligan pretty well. Well, I'm going to keep this hand. This hand is very good if it just draws a land. I think I'm actually going to put back Karn. It's kind of close. Maybe Invoke Despair because they brought in the Test of Talents, but... So it obviously needs to draw a land. Ideally, right away, this hand's amazing. In 2 cards, this hand's pretty good. Nope. It's okay. Still have a little bit of time. Their clock is pretty slow. So he gets to make billions of mana. Oh, Prismatic getting a map. That's also okay. Two endings as bad. We found the land. Awesome. And... yeah, I think I'm going to crack the map. Obviously, the decision is either crack map or Profane Tutor, but like we know there it's a Fairy Time Raveler deck, and I would also like to cast the card next turn, so I think I'm just supposed to crack the map. Would it be great to solve that second map in play so I can get another Coffers and cast the Gristlebrand, but... you can't have it all. This is about... this is hard to hope for too much more when this hand started off so... so rough. And then I think with my opponent just obviously holding up counter magic here, it is better to just play the tutor. And then my opponent's like, if they have Teferi, that's a tap out for Teferi and I can resolve Karn, and maybe I lose the tutor from the Teferi, but if I get to resolve Karn, I think it'll be worth it. And here this doesn't get Test of Talented, and I think if they have Force of Negation, they have to pitch a card, so I'm not feeling too bad about this. I'm definitely just going to grab Torp Orb and cast it if this does resolve. Okay, I wasn't expecting actual factual counterspell in their deck. I will just go ahead and exile it with Cling to Dust. Pass back. We do have a Profane Tutor coming off Suspend, and if I had to choose right now, I'd be getting a Cabal Coffers. I thought for sure this was going to be a Teferi. yeah, just got it. Maybe they Test of Talents the Profane Tutor or something. But I'm going to get a Cabal Coffers if this resolves. Does resolve. There's the Cabal Coffers. Wow, I thought Thoughtseize is one of the best draws here, actually. It's like shockingly good. It's fine. They did have the Test of Talents. Thankfully, they tested Talents the Thoughtseize and not their Profane Tutor. could have kept me off a lot of mana there. So how much do I have? I have 11 mana here. So I have exactly enough to Gristlebrand plus Liliana. I think I will Gristlebrand pay 7 first. I think it's likely I'm just going to go Liliana Edict, but. Don't think it really cost me very much to draw 7 and make sure. They sack the Sanctifier. I guess I shouldn't F6. If they saw to my Gristlebrand, I'll draw 7 more. But it hits us with the GGs though and concedes. What a crazy couple matches here. See you guys in round number 3. Okay, we are on the play for round number 3. With a pretty reasonable hand. I'm going to keep this. Just going to lead on the old Swamp Expedition map. And then we have, you know, 2 instants plus the ability to activate map next turn. Opponent is still deciding if they want to keep their 7 card hand or not. They decide to go to 6. The Cling to Dust has been really good. Sometimes you Profane Tutor for it, but it's just like you're usually really happy to draw the first copy, and then they obviously have diminishing returns. But I think you could play a second copy potentially. Basic Swamp. Be funny if this were the mirror match. If it is, they're almost definitely take the Karn. Karn is like, I've only played the mirror one time, but I think it's the most important card. The worst card in the mirror is actually Urborg, though. Because you might turn on your opponent's Cabal Coffers when you get an Urborg. Alright, they decide to go ahead and take the Karn. They pass back to me. I draw a Liliana of the Veil. I'll just be passing back then. Kind of hoping it's not the mirror. The mirror is kind of goofy. Okay. Well, still could be. Okay, not the mirror, because they would not think any longer than just a second on their fetch. 2-1 to rock. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and I think just grab the Urborg now and then just pull the Ana Edict. Again, just basically always grab the Urborg first. And I don't think I'm probably gonna fix their mana any more than it's already fixed, so. Just play the Urborg now, so I have the upside of Cabal Coffers making a mana next turn. So they have 5 cards in their hand. They're playing some kind of Jund variant, it seems. Maybe just straight red-black. Okay, looks like straight red-black. I haven't seen a Haunted Ridge. Kind of weird to play that over, like, any number of Blackleaf Cliffs. Do they have 3 Turoks in their hand? I feel like I would have probably just waited to kick the Turok next turn. They might. I think they just have 3. So with my read that they just have 3, I'm going to wait to push this until their end of turn. So that if they do have another Turok, they at least have to legend rule. If they don't have another one, I'm pretty happy, because I don't really want to discard 2 cards. Can take 2 pretty easily down to 17. Seasoned Pyromancer, so if they had Turok, they're losing it now. They discard Kroxa and Terminate. Then they play a Shinka. So they're playing a red-black mid-range deck. I've been working on red-black a little bit. I wasn't playing this card, though. I don't think I like it very much. It is kind of interesting with Den of the Bugbear, I suppose. Still not really sold. I'm going to go ahead and exile the Kroxa with the Cling to Dust, because that card is good. And I think we play the Castle Lochtwain. And then if we can draw Cabal Coffers, we do get to use Gristlebrand. I'm not super excited to activate the Castle Lochtwain with this many cards in my hand. We'll see what happens. We do lose the Gristlebrand, which makes the Castle Lochtwain activation less painful. We're at a pretty healthy 16 life after the attack. Opponent's got 1 card left in their hand. Hopefully it's not too scary. Fortunately, the Seasoned Pyromancer is about as good as it gets. Obviously, we're not dead or anything, but... Very good draw for them, and very good draw for us in the Damnation. I think I'll play the Marsh Flats. If they play another a Kroxa or Turok, I'd rather discard the Swamp than the Marsh Flats, since I don't have to lose life because I have Urborg in play. I can just use this as a Swamp, or if I want to get a card in the yard for Kling, I can sacrifice it. Bone Crusher Giant. No, please, my bones. This is also Revolt for Fatal Push. Okay, Inquisition my opponent. I'll take Lightning Bolt over Terminate. And then, I know that like I have the upside of... Yeah, I guess I should just draw now. Like, just the upside of drawing Fatal Push is just way too high. It's compared to the downside of like getting hit by discards effect that they had top deck. It's not a bad draw. Also kind of rewards me for main phasing this. Yeah, not a bad draw at all. Obviously, they've got some good top decks, but I'm feeling pretty good about me top decking out of this. I would say my top decks on average are a lot better than theirs. And I guess they get to play for my top now. 6 down to 9 here. Blast Zone Exiled. Not unhappy about that at all. I think I'm going to upkeep, sack the map. Oh, I was too late. But my thinking here is that like I'm basically locked into getting Cabal Coffers, so why not just do an upkeep to thin a little bit? And then I think I draw a card with Castle while I'm empty-handed. I also have the Cling to Dust. Another Cabal Coffers, okay. I think I'm really unlikely to die next turn, maybe Famous Last Words, but... And it's just Ragavan Terminate, so I don't really see how it happens. And then I don't have Gristlebrand anymore. I still have an Archon of Cruelty in the deck, though. I've got, you know, 4 Invoke Despair. I've got 4 Karns. I've got the Cling to Dust still. Maybe just want to gain some life with Cling since I've got the Castle Lochtwain. They can Seasoned Pyromancer, so we're going to have to wait until after they use one of their seasoned pyromancers to cling if we're gonna commit to gaining life. All right, I'm gonna get a little risky here and take two. We just have so many good draws. That's admittedly not one of them. All right, we just pass back. Now we die to a top deck bolt. Unfortunately, you can't respond to the Seasoned Pyromancer activation with the cling. The exile is part of the cost, not part of the effect. But I can get the other one here. I don't think I really bluff anything. Oh, man. Fatal Push obviously be so much better here. I'll do the Blood Chief's Thirst instead. Do you have 4 push, 2 thirst. Dead 2 top deck bolts from them. Their hand is currently Terminate Mystery card. Totally okay if they cast Liliana. Don't mind that at all. It's actually good for me, I think, with the Castle Locked Wayne. Oh, cool. They can't help themselves either. It's great for me. Din of the Bugbear is not great for me, though. They don't plus the Liliana, which I think is correct. Profane Tutor, unfortunately, looks like it's going to be maybe too little too late. I guess I do sell some outs because I can draw off the castle. Kill this. Suspend the Tutor to take less damage. Tap Urborg for mana. Play Urborg. Castle Locked Wayne. Miss and go to game 2, unfortunately. I think I bring in the Wyrmcoil over the Thoughtseize, number 4. Just submit this. I think 5 discard spells is fine. Could bring in the Emrakul. Maybe I play the Emrakul over the Wyrmcoil. I feel like these games go long. If they discard the Emrakul, I get to shuffle it back in. I'm not sure. Emrakul would have been good that game. So it must be good this game, right? It's at the very least fun. You think I'm going to record this whole video and not bring in the Emrakul once? No way. Yeah, but I do think in this matchup it is pretty easy to get your mana engine online. They have a hard time interacting with that. They just have, like, easier time interacting with your big threats. What a, like, perfect hand for, like... Yeah, just, like... Obviously, the Emrakul is, like, a ways away, but, it's like, I think, like, it is, like, maybe castable on, like, turn 6 if I draw a third Coffers. Maybe not that soon. I'd have to do the math. We've got an early piece of removal. We're pretty resilient to interaction. I'm easy keep. My opponent is taking some time on their mulligan decision. They decide to go to 6. Keep 6, swamp go. I might play Coffers on turn 2 if I feel like the Urborg is going to fix my mana. Like, if my opponent leaves on turn 1 Din of the Bugbear, I'll probably play Cabal Coffers. Alright, take your pick. They probably take the Thirst, but I mean, the Archon is like, it gets cast on turn 5 if I draw 1 land, so they might take that. Really hope they don't have Alpine Moon with this hand. I also don't. I hope they don't Voidwalker Emrakul me. They do take the Blood Chief's Thirst. Let's see what we draw. Swamp. Yeah, I'll play the Coffers just in case they have like a red only land and Voidwalker. Don't think there's like really much cost to Playing around that here. There are plenty of mana to cast their spells. Again, just playing Turok as a 2-1. I guess that's fine. Oh boy. I'm a bit worried because I do feel like they have a another Turok playing this out like this. But boy, do I want to hard cast the Simrakul. Like, there's a... I think we can hard cast it on turn 6, potentially. So it's like 2, make 6. Minus 2, plus 4. 8. No, it would have to be turn 7. I think we could discard the swamp. It's like kind of close. Hoping we draw like Invoke Despair next turn. Or just like anything to impact the board, really. Opponent is thinking about what they want to discard, which I usually recommend deciding before you play Liliana. I really want to cast the Emrakul for the video. Okay, we do have, so we have 6 mana this turn. Unfortunately, nothing to do with it. Next turn, though, we get to hardcast Archon into hardcast Emrakul. Assuming we draw 1 lands, which I'm going to try to. Oh, pain. Pain, pain, pain. So I guess we have to discard the Emrakul to the Liliana since it shuffles the Archon back in, and I think that we actually just can't hardcast the Emrakul before we can't. I guess we could draw runner lands. Don't know that it's worth it. Maybe it is for the video. So they take Archon, we discard Marsh Flats, we draw a land, play a card. Play Cabal Coffers, discard that card, draw a land. It's still, yeah, still not enough for the Emrakul, so we have to discard it, I think. Wait, what are they thinking about? I think they're thinking... Maybe they just want to Edict the Archon. Yeah, this is... not really a decision for them. 2 cards left in their hands. Kind of the same situation we were in last game. I feel like, I guess, a pretty common situation for this matchup, I imagine, where... You got millions of mana, or you're about to have millions of mana. Your opponent gets all of your threats out of your hand, and you just need to top deck anything. Invoke Despair, card, Griselbrand, Archon of Cruelty. Maybe not the Emrakul again. In the last game, we couldn't top deck any of those cards. Opponent is struggling over there. This card's Din of the Bugbear. It's a pretty good card to have. I'm kind of surprised they must have something like a Haymaker in their hand that they want to save. Well, it stinks that I just shuffled my graveyard back in. I am gonna just cycle cling to dust first. Oh boy. Well, I don't know what we're getting. We're going to get something. We have 10 mana. Could get Bolas's Citadel. I think it's just probably for the best to get a Wurmcoil and put it into play. Maybe Ballista's... Ballista's only a 3-3. It's going to be pretty tough for them to... deal with the Wurmcoil and deal with the Karn this turn. Maybe they could just kill the Karn and then chump block the Wurmcoil and ultimate Liliana. That'd be kind of bad. Discard Kroxa. Okay, that's like definitely their draw for the turn. And I maybe the last card is like Kolaghan's Command. That might be a card they would have kept over Din. It's Ashiok? Alright, I guess we win. Just gonna Ballista. Ashiok's okay. We've got Profane Tutor and Expedition Map. Okay, I guess let's have a little fun, huh? We get to kill the Liliana. We're about to gain 6 life. I'm going to cast a Bolas of Citadel. Put a Pax it in before we get to have our fun. Okay, we get to go to game 3. Maybe I should reevaluate this whole Imrakul thing. 16 mana is a lot. 15 mana is a lot, sorry. I'll leave it in for the video. It's probably not super correct to board in, but I'll leave it in. Okay, we do have 3 1 mana interactive spells. We also have a one lander, so we have to send it back, I think. Gonna keep this hand, I suppose. I think we put back the Karn here. It's kind of close between that and Invoke Despair, I think. Okay, happy to have a push for the Ragavan. With no counter spells, just wait till attacks to play around Dash Ragavan. Although I will say, the more and more I play in Modern, the more I'm just like not that scared of turn 2 dash Dragavan. Obviously, like, it's still like sometimes correct to do it, but it's usually just not a very scary play. They do have a second Ragavan and a second land. Well, pretty straightforward turn Inquisition, then cast Expedition Map. Take the Turok. Draw Black Source, we get to Edict the Ragavan, assuming they brick. What are we discarding if they Kroxa? That's kind of close. I think I'll discard the Damnation, be greedy. Seems fine. Alright, Fatal Push, not a super helpful hit for them. Wouldn't have been that bad a draw for me. They do cast the Kroxa. Discard the Damnation. They're 2 cards away from escaping. Now 0 cards if we Edict the Ragavan. I think it's now or never on the Profane Tutor, so I'm going to have those options elect now. And not feel great about my spot, obviously. Exiles a swamp from the top of my library. Draws another Mire to escape the Kroxa. So continuing to feel pretty bad about her spot. Guess I'm pretty forced to discard Invoke Despair. The Den of the Bugbear is a lot of pressure. I think we're going to draw Imrakul for turn. That's my guess. Never lucky. All right, right on time. Turn 4, Liliana. Edict you. Don't really, I feel like, see a lot of ways out of this. They get to hit me for 6, 9, 12 damage. I really don't think I've got outs, guys. I think I'm going to concede. I guess I could draw Fatal Push for turn, tutor Fatal Push. Yeah, okay. It's good enough to play it out. Alright, dead. Not dead this turn, but my double Fatal Push line does not get the job done. And we fall to 2-1. Pretty fun match, though. I'll see you guys in round number 4. Okay, on the play for round number 3, I'm going to keep. I've been in this spot a couple times where obviously you have the choice of turn 1 map or turn 1 Thoughtseize. I think you're basically always supposed to Thoughtseize first. Unless you, like, maybe understand the, what matchup you're playing or have, like, a super specific hand that, like, needs to turn four, get your mana engine going or something. Okay, we're playing against Heliod. Not sure how this matchup is. Trying to think if we can beat Infinite Life. I'm going to take the Utopia Sprawl, I think. Yeah, I think this is fine. They go turn one Elf, I go turn two Map, they go turn three Heliod. Then I go turn three Edict their Arbor Elf. Just go on from there. So I can bring in the Imrakul to beat Infinite Life. I don't think I can beat it game one. Okay, well now we're just gonna push the Elf and then play the map. They played a Prismatic Vista that we didn't know that was in their hand previously. This is, I think, gonna be one of those classic... I should have maybe played my Swamp here, actually. I think just one of those classic Liliana, no activation. Yeah, beating Imrakul, Imrakul beating Infinite Life is kind of convoluted, but you just, like, can blow up their board, sack your Imrakul to Liliana, and just kind of move on. okay, let's play the Karn. I'm pretty sure I'm grabbing Torpor Orb with this one. I'm not 100% sure. Stops a lot of cards in their deck, and we could maybe assemble a lock of Torpor Orb and Snaring Bridge Needle on Spike Feeder Karn, because Karn shuts off Ballista. Okay, Karn goes to one loyalty. Plays their Ranger Captain. Yeah, them sacking Ranger Captain and upkeep, it can also be a bit of a problem. They get Ballista. We'll see what they do here. They don't sack the Ranger Captain and upkeep. We are actually, like, a little soft to them sacking it in the upkeep next turn, to be honest. But I think we set up for Karn plus Bridge next turn, and so hope they don't sack. I mean, they're probably going to. I guess they also, like, they're still not Heliod comboing me though, right? Because they need a, yeah, they're 2 mana short of Heliod comboing me next turn. Okay. So they're going to kill my Karn, hit me for 3, down to 14. And in their hand is currently Heliod, Walking Ballista, 2 mystery cards. Heliod is a creature, but if they sack an upkeep, it's not a creature anymore. They feel like they can't sack an upkeep. I have exactly enough mana for Karn for Bridge. So now if they... Now if they do draw a Spike Feeder, like, things are weird. But I think they do deck a turn before I do. And I think that if I can, like, yeah, this should, I don't think that they can actually win from this position. Okay, just Skyclave, no ETB because of Torpor Orb. I am going to needle Spike Feeder if I get to on top of the Karn, of course. Because I don't actually think they can beat that. Wait, they didn't gain infinite life here? Not sure why they wouldn't do that. I think I'll take the Ranger Captain so they can't upkeep sack. Not that I think it's super relevant. I guess they just assume I can beat infinite life. But this should be like the hard lock, unless I guess they could maybe have Prismatic Ending in their deck. March of Otherworldly Light. Okay, plays their Spike Feeder. Might as well level up the Blast Zone, I guess. I don't think I'm probably second it for one this game, or two or three, to be honest. What a weird game. There's Ariok Champion, Mystery Card, or maybe the Ballista, which again is turned off by the Karn. So I can't just minus two the Karn next turn either. My opponent's still playing, so like I guess they've got Prismatic Ending in their deck. Right now, they've just got a mystery card over there. Yeah, I'll just go to Impless for now, and then I think I'm probably going to gain life with Cling to Dust end of turn, and then get Bolas's Citadel with Karn. Spellskite would be pretty nice as a Karn target right now. I saw the two mana, my heart kind of skipped a beat there. Invoke Despair. I think I'll just discard that to Lily. I know, like, you know, Ensnaring Bridge games are always so weird. A lot of times just don't make any sense. Okay, I want a Liliana ultimate next turn, so I'll just wait for now. Not do anything else. I'll probably just put lands versus permanents next turn. Oh, yeah, Profane Tutor plus Bolas the Citadel is a pretty sick combo. Yeah, but I think I like the lands versus permanents split. I suppose I should break up the Utopia Sprawl on the land. Alright, that worked. Don't need to overthink this too much. I think I'll just get a Damnation. A lone Heliod stares upon a lonely battlefield. So I guess now if my opponent, okay, I was thinking about, if my opponent's going to make me play it out, I'll just kill my own bridge. Okay, cool game. I'll bring in the Turok, card's pretty good in the matchup. And I think I'll cut the Cling to Dust. Okay, on the draw for game two against Heliod. Kind of a medium hand here. I think I'm going to try it. I haven't really played against much Heliod lately, but they also mulled a six on the play. This hand can maybe generate some mana. This may be a hand where you tutor up Cabal Coffers instead of Urborg, since we already have three swamps. And they go to 5, so I think I feel pretty good about this keep against the 5-card hand. Blast Zone is, may randomly be good against, like, the Utopia Sprawls and stuff. There's and stuff. Okay, we can now we can get both Cabal Coffers and Urborg. So, potentially we just go for turn 2 crack map, turn 3 playing crack map, turn 4 Cabal Coffers Urborg. Huh. Although now I'm pretty likely to want to Blast Zone on turn 4. We'll see what happens, see what we draw. We're definitely locked into just cracking map this turn now. I think I'm maybe gonna play Liliana next turn. It just kind of depends on what they do. Only have 2 cards in their hand. Okay, so they're gonna use their Arborel for mana, which is maybe not good news. But you might think that they would. Okay, so they just have Collected Company. So let me get Cabal Coffers. Maybe Urborg was still better, actually. Yeah, Urborg was actually, I think, still better. Not going to be a huge difference. I'm going to Edict them here. And we'll see how good their Collected Company is. Which I'm assuming they cast in response. Oh, they sacked Horizon Canopy to draw a card. They don't even have Collected Company. That's so sad. Maybe they have Veil of Summer? No Veil of Summer. Like the old actual bluff Collected Company. I respect it. Hoping that they attack Liliana. Spike Feeder, okay. Oh, I forgot to bring in the Emrakul. Dang it, I'm sorry. We had this whole talk about how I was going to bring in Emrakul. I just didn't do it. I can Inquisition to try to take Heliod out of their hand. I can go Inquisition, then crack map for Urborg this turn, and then Evoke Despair next turn, or I can just Blast Zone. Then I lose the land Heliod, which I wouldn't lose to if I just brought in the Emrakul, but Besageu and Force of Vigor. Two surprising cards to see. See how kind the top of their library is. Double check that I don't have outs. I'm pretty sure I don't. Yeah, Ballista doesn't do it. Wyrmcoil obviously doesn't do it. So I play the Invoke Despair, they sacrifice the Utopia Sprawl and the Arbor Elf, probably. Okay, yeah, so let's just go Damnation here, then. So that they can't top deck Heliod. They may Besage you my Urborg, which would be fine, because my Cabal Coffers would just still make mana. Let's see just how much despair we can invoke today. I don't think I care that much about Thoughts using the Force of Vigor this turn. I could do that next turn. And I'm just going to get a coding and kind of like tell my opponent that they need to answer the coding more than they need to besage you my Cabal Coffers. Ranger Captain, and you gotta imagine that they're gonna sack this in the upkeep, but then I get to like maybe play my own Ballista or something. Finds an Arbor Elf. Plays the Besageu, plays the Arbor Elf. Wow. I guess they still have the Force of Vigor. And I'm also surprised to see them not using the Ranger Captain here. Okay, so we know the last card is just a Force of Vigor. So let's go Coding, kill a Temple Garden, Turok as a 2-1, pro white, and then Thoughtseize to make it a 3-2, and stop them from Force of Vigoring my Coding. We can cast the Archon next turn, even through Ranger Captain Sack. Have a hard time imagining my opponent's going to really be able to get out of this one. Yeah, even the Heliod doesn't do anything because I just get to get them down to just 2 mana. And they pack it in. We advance to 3-1. Kind of a weird league so far, but I'll see you guys in round number 4. Okay, we are on the draw for round number 4. I think I'm going to go ahead and take a mulligan. I like this hand well enough to keep. I think we can afford to put back the basic swamp, since on turn 4, this Profane Tutor is going to come down and grab us a Cabal Coffers. We're pretty likely to draw a land on the way there, playing against Affinity. Swamp Thoughtseize. Hopefully we draw something to do on turn 3 and turn 4. Relic, Springleaf Drum, Urza Saga. Pretty good ham. I'm going to take the Springleaf Drum. Pretty good hand, though. So imagine they cast the Relic. See if they drew anything else for this turn. It'd be pretty bad for us if they did. Definitely a game where I would have loved to be on the play. Gonna suspend the Profane Tutor. The Damnation was a really good draw. Really good draw. If I draw a second Cabal Coffers, I'm assuming I get one off the Profane Tutor, I might be able to Gristlebrand the turn after the Damnation. Not sure. Take the tutor down, big draw step, and worst draw of the deck, second herb board. It's fine. I'm pretty sure that I'm getting a Cabal Coffers. Like, my Gristlebrand is just like so locked in the hand if I don't. And you only have 7 mana next turn. I could also grab a Karn, potentially. I could also grab a second Damnation. I could grab an Invoke Despair. I think it's just gotta be Cabal Coffers. Probably overthinking it a little too much. Nice that Damnation beats Welding Jar here too, if they go for Welding Jar. So not necessarily thinking they have that in their main deck, I guess. We're taking a whole 7 points here though. Oh, 8, 9 points. Yikes. Down to 9. Another Cabal Coffers also does let me Gristlebrand next turn. Yeah, we just need the engine going. Okay, well, I can't play and crack that and not die, but I can at least cast the map. Which I could maybe use to get a Blast Zone. Can I play and crack Blast Zone next turn? I actually have exactly enough. But I'm not sure how helpful that is, that I can do that. I guess it does shrink the construct. It makes the construct too smaller. They don't know any card in their hand either. So I played my Castle Locked Way, and I got one short of Gristlebrand next turn, unfortunately. And if I do go for the Blast Zone line, I'm still a short of Griselbrand. Oh, they're going for Thought Monitor and not making a Saga token, which I think is great for me. Okay. It's not mana positive to crack the map, is it? So I go 4, 2 mana crack map. Play Cabal Coffers. I have 2 floating. Yeah, it's mana neutral, right? I need to tap this to... I can't play my land before I activate this Coffers and get the other Coffers. I think I still get a Coffers here, and then I have tons of mana next turn. But the Griselbrand is probably not going to be good enough since I have one less mana than I thought. But they do have this Aether Spell Bomb, so, and they have enough damage to get me down to 5, so I can't even activate the Griselbrand. So we're gonna need to draw something. They're not making a token again. I guess that's bad for me. I assume it's bad for me. They've already got their Ginger Brute, so they just get a Springleaf Drum. So weird that they wouldn't make a token. Another Thought Monitor, pretty scary. Plays Treasure Vault for turn. I guess we're dead to Cranial Plating, not dead to Nettle Cyst. Now, still dead to Cranial Plating. I think I might have enough mana for Karn plus Griselbrand, so maybe drawing Karn is my out. Karn or Damnation, obviously, but we only have one Damnation. Okay, they've got the Cranial Plating. Takes their time casting it. And Magical Light not showing me the card, saying I don't want to know what it is. Don't want to know what it is. Okay, game 2 on the play. I'm just gonna resubmit here. You know, we are a Karn the Great Creator deck. The card goes a long way in the matchup. I'm not 100% sure who's favored. I know I've beaten Affinity a couple times with this list, but really not a big enough sample size to have a strong opinion on the matchup. Very close hand. I think we kept a hand pretty close to this earlier. I'm gonna keep again. We have 2 cheap interactive spells. We really have like 2 turns to draw the land before it starts to get really bad. It's obviously kind of risky, but you know, with these like synergistic decks in Modern, you always have to take some risks. And their hand was like surprisingly weak to Thoughtseize. I think it's better to take the Minmite than it is one of the drums. Maybe that's not true. Cause like if I take the Thought Monitor, my opponent goes turn 1, Saga, drum. I guess they still don't really want to do that though, because then they need to draw an untapped land to make its token on turn 2 anyways. Not sure. Two players with awkward hands this game, I guess. Opponent is thinking. Definitely thinking about playing Saga on turn 1, I think. If they are thinking about playing Saga on turn 1, they must have just drawn another 0 drop, because I feel like there's basically nothing else makes any sense, but they decide to just play a bridge. And we do not draw a non... We do need to draw a non-Cabal Coffers land, admittedly. We fail to do so on this turn. Saga. Drum. I really expected a zero drop there. Okay, I mean, I'm happy that there wasn't one. And we do get to find an Urborg for next turn. Obviously, if my opponent just doesn't have another land that makes mana that enters untapped, we're pretty happy. All of our cards interacting at sorcery speed are pretty bad against the end of turn token, of course. Awesome. Very lucky for us. I always like these games where, like, both players are drawing, like, just, like, the bottom percentage of their draws, and things are weird, and nobody knows what to do. I usually have a good time in these hands. I'm trying to think what to do here. I think I'm just going to play Liliana and plus discard second Liliana. Because I might actually get Blast Zone with this Expedition map. Because we know they have another Springleaf Drum in their hand. They might discard the Springleaf Drum, I suppose, too. We also have a ton of mana and not a lot to do with it. Sometimes you'll get Takanuma with your Expedition map when you've got a lot of mana. We might also get Castle Locked Wayne. They did discard the Springleaf Drum. There's also, like, a pretty good chance that they get Gingerbrute with Urza Saga, then equip Nettle Cyst, which will be another good spot for the Blast Zone. We really just kind of don't want them to cast the Thought Monitor here, but they're pretty likely to, since they're going to have... No, they have enough mana if they tap the drums. They do get the Gingerbrute. I guess we can't actually sack the Blast Zone next turn, can we? Yeah, we needed to actually cast the Expedition map. Sorry to do that next turn. Yikes. Might not be good enough anyways. Well, imagine my opponent's ignoring Liliana at this point, unless their last card is... I don't know what the last card could be for them to, like, even Nettle Cyst. I feel like you just attack me. Yeah, they do just attack me. And... is Karn on the list of cards that gets me out of this? Should be. I think it's on that list. Exactly enough to Karn for bridge, and then I can plus one and not get attacked by the Frogmite. I guess I should have plus one first because of rebuke. But now they can't rebuke anymore. Just a mistake to not do it before. And yeah, so usually you'd be able to Cranial Plating, move on the Midmite through a bridge, but because I have Karn, they can't activate Cranial Plating's ability. They also can't tap for any mana. So I think that my opponent is probably going to pack it in. At the very least, I don't know how they win from this spot. They get to attack for one more, and they attack the Karn. I guess they have to hope my hand is, like, gummed up somehow, but the problem is, like, with Liliana, I can't have a gummed up hand. Yeah, I'm just gonna get another Coffers and then play the map, not crack the map, because of bridge. Plus the card on their Mist Vault bridge. But it might just be interested to see how I win at this point, so I suppose I might just, like, get a Blista, but they decide it's not worth their time, and I think that's a wise decision. I'm going to submit for game 3, and it kind of all comes down to this, either 3-2 or 4-1. Hoping for 4-1. Okay, love the sand. Love the sand. Not perfect, but love it. And my opponent most of five on the play. We've got Karn, which is great against them. Double push to buy time in the late game. Damnation's one of our best cards. We also have Urborg Cabal Coffers after we crack them out. Okay, against the mold to five, I'm definitely thought seizing here. Cranial Plating, S champion. I'll just go and take the plating. We have the damnation for that champion. They drew Saga for turns. Probably their best draw. Okay, let's suspend Profane Tutor here. That is kind of like one bad thing about Tutor is like you really do need to suspend it on turn two most games, but it's usually worth it. Land would be nice, don't need to draw lands. Should I Thoughtseize the Etz champion? I don't think so. Maybe I should. I guess I can play and crack map next turn if I want to. Probably gonna push one of the Saga tokens to not take a big hit. But their hand is just a treasure vault. Not sure if they have anything crazy good to get off Saga. Don't really care even if it's like Welding Jar. Also, like, can't really imagine that their play is anything besides make a token, treasure vault, springleaf draw. Maybe they get Bomek. Maybe they get Gingerbrut. Which is also just not too scary. They did get Welding Jar. I don't really mind because I do get to damnation in two turns if I really want to. Just push and then they'll regenerate and well I guess I'm trying to think, do I need to push next turn to buy time? Maybe it was a mistake to let them get the Welding Jar. Things get pretty easy if I just draw any land here. Okay, easy then. Yeah, we just play an expedition map and upkeep. No, I don't want to upkeep push. If they have a counter spell, I'd rather them counter the push than the damnation. But just push to gain 7 life. Okay. Yeah, maybe I haven't sequenced everything perfectly here, but we are pretty ahead at this point, I think. Let's go ahead and just fire off the damnation. Obviously, we were hoping to get a little bit more value out of it this game. The decision to Thoughtseize made ended up having been bad, but it is also true we've got a Karn in our hand. If my opponent can't put any pressure into play, it's just over, and it might be over anyways because I can get Bridge and play Bridge. Right, I've got 7 mana. Yeah, I got 7 mana. Alright, they can't make any mana the rest of the game. I get to bridge, and I think it is over. Opponent's making sure I didn't accidentally shuffle the bridge back into my deck, which is a mistake you could really only make in paper. Or I guess you can make it more often in paper. Alright, they pack it in. Karn good against the Affinity deck. Hot takes here on Channel Fireball. I'll go ahead and open these chests and send you on your way. This is a deck I like a lot. I really do recommend it. I think it's a lot of fun. I think there's a lot of creativity in how you can build the list. I put a little guide up on Channel Fireball too. On the CFB Pro side if you want to check that out. I used to play this card in EDH. Good times. Ring of Three Wishes. Alright, and I'll see you guys later. Bye.